Steve, the search for extraterrestrial life is something that fascinates everyone. I know I've felt that way since I've been a child, but what I've realized more recently is that it's not just a question of curiosity, but it reflects deeply on the nature of the universe, on what it's all about, whether there is life beyond Earth that's intelligent. What is the history of the human quest for this understanding of extraterrestrial life?
Well, many people don't realize that the debate over extraterrestrial life goes all the way back to the ancient Greeks, as many things do. But what I found in my work on the history of the extraterrestrial life debate is that the debate, far from being an unusual or not very reputable subject, actually is associated with cosmologies, and that starts with the ancient Greeks, the ancient atomist cosmology. Where the Democritus and Leucippus, Epicurus, believed that the universe was full of atoms. They said that our own world was finite, but the number of atoms is infinite. Therefore, there must be other worlds out there, and an infinite number of worlds, some of which are inhabited and some of which are not inhabited. So that was the beginning, all the way back in the 4th century B.C. Now, the tradition of ancient atomism, the cosmology of ancient atomism, was not the one that was passed down to the Latin West in the Middle Ages. That was the cosmology of Aristotle. And Aristotle believed just the opposite. Aristotle believed that there was only a single world, and by world he meant the cosmos, the entire system of our own planets, all the way out to the fixed stars. He believed there could only be one of those, and that's the tradition that was passed down to the Middle Ages.
And then that got mired in church theology.
Exactly. Very quickly. Christianity, you had the problem of reconciling Christianity with this view of a single world, because the first question is, well, if there's only a single world, what if God wanted to create more than one world? And so what most of the scholastics in the Middle Ages decided was that, well, if God wanted to create another world, he certainly could, but in reality, he didn't create another world. So the feeling in the Middle Ages certainly was that there was only a single world, a single cosmos, and that's really, for hundreds of years, was the main cosmology. Now, that changed. That all changed with Copernicus, and the foundation for everything that we believe today about life on other planets really goes back to Copernicus in the 16th century, because Copernicus is the one who made the Earth a planet and made the planets potential Earths. When you take the Earth out of the center of the system, you no longer have a geocentric system, and you put the Sun in the center and put the Earth and the other planets going around it, well, the other planets are just
candidates,
potentially other Earths. And so that was the foundation, although Copernicus himself did not put forward any ideas about life in other worlds, other people very quickly did. One of the most fascinating ones is Giordano Bruno. Giordano Bruno, if you go today to Rome, to the Piazza Campo dei Fiori, the Field of Flowers, you'll see a statue of Bruno, which was erected in the 19th century, at the very site where he was burned at the stake in February of 1600, in part for his belief in an infinite number of worlds based on the Copernican theory. Bruno wrote many books on this and was, in many ways, although he had a very philosophical kind of a disposition, in many ways began a lot of the ideas that we have today about life in other worlds. He believed that there was an infinite number of worlds, some of which may be inhabited and some of which may not. So Bruno, in a lot of ways, was ahead of his time. But in the course of the 17th century, when the Copernican theory gradually became more accepted, people started to talk more and more about the implications. And of course, this also got involved with Christianity and what does Scripture say? Does Scripture say you can have more worlds or not? And in particular, it got involved with Christian doctrines, especially the doctrine of incarnation. If you have many worlds, were the people on those worlds saved by Christ dying on this world? And so you have this this picture of a sort of a planet-hopping Christ. If the answer to that is no, if you say that Christ by dying on Earth did not save the people on the other worlds.
Then he's got to go to all those other places.
Then he's got to go around the universe.
Or you need a different system, and none of those seem particularly satisfying.
That's right. So that question was already raised in the Middle Ages in the 14th century. But of course, they got around it by saying that
there are no other worlds.
But in the 17th century, when they seriously began to consider that there might be other worlds, then this became a serious question. And so you see this whole working out of what the options are with respect to that question.
So what about the modern development of the debate?
Well, in the 18th century, I should say that the belief in extraterrestrials really went from heretical to becoming widespread. And that was partly because of theological reasons, curiously enough. The Newtonian world system had made God less of an actor in the world because God didn't need to move the planets. There was now Newtonian gravitation to do that. And so, in part as compensation for that, the natural philosophers of the time, including Newton and his successors, said, well, God doesn't have to move the planets, but there are many habitable worlds out there. And so this was a part of what's called natural theology, a part of the idea that the magnificence and glory of the universe reflects on God, and it would be a much better and more glorious universe if there were a lot of inhabitants out there. So you had that idea already in the 18th century, became widespread, and as I say, it's ironic that in part because of theology, that is the reason why that became so widespread. So then in the 19th century, you still have this working out of the religious versus the scientific worldviews. I mean, there were really three possibilities. You could either believe in a plurality of habited worlds, or you could believe in Christianity, or you could try and reconcile the three. And you see all three of those options being played out in the 19th century. Some people like Thomas Paine, the famous person who wrote Common Sense, said in that, and in the Age of Reason, that with regard to Christianity and the plurality of worlds, that he who thinks he believes in both has thought little about either. Of course, Paine was controversial for many things aside from that. And then there were other people who rejected plurality of worlds. William Ewell in England is one of them. A.R. Wallace, who was the co-founder with Darwin of the theory of natural selection at the beginning of the 20th century, believed that. About every 50 years or so, you get this really strong strongly reasoned arguments on that. And then there were people who tried to reconcile the two. So that's what you see happening in the 19th century, and this is all the background for the 20th century when things really take off.